All right. God bless our Bishop Charles Blake. We praise him. Praise God as you come, everybody.
I just want to praise you. Lift my hands and say, I love you. You are everything to me. Oh, and I just want to say thank you, Lord. Oh, I just want to praise you.
It's good to be in God's house tonight. And is there anybody here who came to praise the Lord tonight? Is there anybody here who has come expecting something from God? You don't want to leave here as you were when you came. You need a miracle from God. You're glad to see the folk, but you want to have a personal moment of presence of the Almighty God. You want a spiritual experience with God tonight. How many of you mean business about this worship service? Turn over toward your neighbor and say, hey neighbor, if you didn't come to worship the Lord tonight, you might want to change your seat. Because I came here to give the Lord some praise and give the Lord some glory. Hallelujah. And we give high honor to the presiding bishop of the Church of God in Christ, Bishop G.E. Patterson. We're also very, very happy to see and very honored to see. We have been so in prayer for him and upholding his arms with our prayers. The Bishop George McKinney is with us on tonight. He suffered grievous loss, and all of us were so lifted as we saw the Lord strengthen and encourage him. And as we saw his great family gather around him on Monday, we've been praying for you, Bishop, and we're overjoyed to see you in the house of the Lord with us on this night. We're also overjoyed to see the Bishop F.J. Goodman in the house on tonight. God bless him. And then Bishop Samuel Moore of Brazil is here. Let's praise God for him. Bishop Irvin Perry of the Third Jurisdiction of Southern California is also with us. I'm overjoyed for a personal dear friend of mine, and we praise God that he has come over to be with us. Some of you may not realize that Dr. Gregory Dixon of First Church of God lost his mother this week, or maybe late last week, and many of our Church of God brothers and sisters are coming in town to extend their support to Dr. Gregory Dixon, who will be preaching his mother's funeral on tomorrow. I know that's going to take a great dose of spiritual strength for him to do that. If I lose my mother, don't even expect me to say hello to you. I just might look at you and shake your hand. All I want to do is scream and holler. Amen, because that's my mama. But we're praying that the Lord will strengthen him on tomorrow. And the presiding elder of the National Association of the Church of God in Christ, and also the Bishop of the Berean Fellowship of Churches, Bishop Timothy J. Clark, First Church of God, Columbus, Ohio. Where are you, Bishop Clark? Stand and let's welcome him also to the house of the Lord. There are a host of elders and pastors from other jurisdictions here on tonight, and we certainly honor each and every one of you. We praise God for our state supervisor, Mother Barbara Lewis. Let's give the Lord a hand for her. Oh, she really did teach on last night. She teached loud and she taught with a tune and she just blessed us real good. And then the people of the Lord were so blessed by her ministry on last night. Souls were filled with the Holy Ghost and bodies were healed. And we praise God for the greatest state supervisor on the face of the earth. Then the most exquisite and beautiful and sophisticated and sweet First Lady on the face of the earth, Sister May L. Blake. Let's praise God for her. Enjoy that wonderful sermonette coming from Elder Chris Green. Amen. Amen. Shared the word of the Lord. We were hoping that there would be some service left when we came down, because he was really proclaiming the word powerfully. And well, let's praise God for all the pastors of Southern California. Please, pastors, will you please stand? Pastors, please stand. Please stand. Let's praise God for these men of God. This has been a great convocation so far. And we look forward to not only the word of God coming from our presiding bishop, but also to welcome a new class of elders to the ranks of the ministers of the gospel in Southern California jurisdiction number one, a fine group of men who have been trained and prepared for this day. And on this night, they will have a distinct honor, not only of their own bishops, hands laid upon them, but the hands of the presiding bishop himself and other guest bishops who are with us on this night will lay hands upon you, ordaining you to the work of the Lord, not particularly to the office of an elder, but to the responsibility, the higher responsibility of doing a special work for the Lord Jesus Christ. So we praise God for each of these candidates for ordination whom we will receive on tonight. This is a banner night. Jurisdictions all over the world long for the privilege that we enjoy. Jurisdictions all over this nation of ours write to our presiding bishop and ask him to come and share, and there's literally no way that he can come to all of the jurisdictions that invite him, though he is powerful and though he has a great presence. He is not omnipresent. He can only be in one place at one time. And we want our presiding bishop to live a long time. We want him to be in good health. Amen. And so he just simply cannot retain his health and sanity and go everywhere that he is asked to go. He has to rest. He has to conserve his energy, and he cannot accept every invitation that he receives. We're so blessed that to have retained him in Southern California since Monday. He's been in Southern California since Monday. Some of our elders, Elder J.A. Blake, Elder Clavester Williams, and others have had the wonderful privilege of hosting him and taking him to do one of the things that he enjoys more than anything else, and that's fishing for 2 or 3 days. And we just praise God that we've been able to keep him here and rest him up and give him some recreation. And so we feel like we are just special. We feel like we are privileged characters because we have had him with us for a few days, and we have him with us on tonight. Are you glad to see our presiding bishop? I've always recognized the wisdom that God has deposited in him. But since he has become the presiding bishop of the Church of God in Christ, countless instances have come before the general board that have just really impressed me by the profound wisdom that God has deposited into the heart and the mind and the spirit of this great man of God. And he has literally transform the face of the Church of God in Christ at headquarters across the nation and around the world. And we receive a level of respect from the ecumenical community that we have never received before because of the greatness and the profound wisdom and renown of our great leader, Bishop G.E. Patterson. So this is like a national holiday for us because our leader is here, and we've got every cause to celebrate. And when a minister normally comes, we sometimes make provision to receive a love offering, an after offering, after the main offering and after his ministry. But this is just not a minister coming to visit us. This is our spiritual father, our leader, our presiding officer, our chief shepherd of the Church of God in Christ, who is with us on this night. And I just think it would be inappropriate for us to do anything else but show him our love by presenting the offering of the evening to his ministry. Not so much to him as to his ministry, because money, yes, does come to him, but it comes through him. Thousands of letters and requests for assistance and for help come to his desk, and he must respond because he is the leader of the Church of God in Christ, and he leads us in the ministry of giving as a denomination. And I remember in one very short period, more than $250,000. Within 1 year, our presiding bishop just gave it for the growth of the church and the upbuilding of the work of God. He is not one who is just trying to get all he can and can all he gets, but God has made him a channel of blessing to the people of the Lord. And I just think we ought to praise God for that fact. And I just feel that since the first jurisdiction of Southern California is the largest of all the jurisdictions in the Church of God in Christ anywhere, I just feel like we ought to do more for our leader than anybody else does anywhere on the face of the earth. I love Bishop G.E. Patterson. I praise God for him. I had the dubious distinction of being one of the competitors for the office of presiding bishop. I ran against him for the office of presiding bishop, and immediately after he was elected as presiding bishop, one would think that he would turn to those who had supported his candidacy, who had stood with him in the election. But when he became presiding bishop, the first thing he did, the first official act as presiding bishop, was to turn and say, "I am selecting Bishop Charles E. Blake as my first assistant." I think that's a huge heart and a generous spirit. And he has seen to it that I receive all of the honor and all of the respect that the office I hold should appropriately receive, and even more. There is no insecurity, no jealousy within this man, no narrowness. This is a generous and a great leader. And I want us to enable this great man of God to do some things in ministry that he otherwise would not have been able to do because of our generosity tonight. I want him to be able to say, because Southern California shared so generously with me, I am able to do this or to do that for the work of the Lord. And before, I might not have had the capacity or the inclination to do it. And so we're going to share with the man of God on tonight. Aren't you glad for the privilege of blessing the prophet of God? When you tie yourself to the ministry of an individual, you receive the blessings that God pours out upon that minister. You are a recipient of God's anointing on him, because your ministry and your generosity to him is literally part and parcel of his ministry. And Bishop G.E. Patterson has a great ministry, and we're going to share in the ministry of our great leader. I want every one of you to open your heart to the Spirit of the Lord tonight and let God touch the strings of liberality within your spirit, and we're going to bless the man of God. Before I left my office, I sat down and wrote a check for $1,000 for this offering on tonight. And I want those of you whom the Lord will touch to join with me or to give as large an offering as you are able to give. I don't want any of the administrative assistants, unless it is absolutely necessary for you to do less, to give less than a $200 offering on tonight. And I want every pastor to strive to give a $100 offering. I want every superintendent to strive to give a $150 offering. I want these evangelist missionaries who can to give generously on tonight, district missionaries. I want all of you to share in whatever capacity or level you are able to share. I want everybody in this auditorium who is able to give at least a $25 offering on tonight. Celebrate the ministry of one of the greatest men of God on the face of the earth. I'm so happy for my special guest bishops. And they didn't just come here to hear. They came because they wanted to share in this ministry on tonight. And I praise God for each of them. who will share. Those of you who will share in the categories that I have mentioned, I want you to please stand all over this auditorium. All over this auditorium. All over this auditorium. Amen. All over this auditorium. Thank you, Pastor Ron Gibson, for your gift of $500. Whatever category you may be in, if you will give at least a gift of $25 in this offering tonight, would you stand very quickly? Our leader is too dignified and too great for me to tarry or even to beg. I just want you to stand with your gift in hand, prepare to share with the work of the Lord. Preacher, I couldn't give what you asked me to give, but I'm going to do my best. I'm going to give what God would have me to give in this offering on tonight. Would you please stand all over this auditorium? Everybody will stand. Hallelujah. I like for people to smile at offering time. Smile, please. All over the auditorium, please stand. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of sharing with the man of God. We thank you for the privilege of sharing with the ministry of this your leader. We thank you for the excellent leadership that he provides and for the blessings that we receive because G.E. Patterson is our presiding bishop. We give with joy, and we ask that you would bless us this night as we share with the work of the Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Thank God. Amen. Clap your hands and praise God for the privilege of giving. I want you to resume your seats. Make out your checks to the Church of God in Christ, please. Make your checks out to the Church of God in Christ. Please resume your seats now. You're honest people of the Lord, and this is why we can just let you sit back down and just know that you're going to give exactly what you have indicated you're going to give. The ushers are going to serve you. The choir is going to minister to us. God bless you as you give.
We praise you. I want to do. I have many people out there that love the Lord Jesus. I want to see you stand to your feet and clap your hands in this place. Come on. Let's declare, let's proclaim that he is awesome.
The Lord our God is holy. The Lord our God is righteous. The Lord our God is holy. The Lord our God is righteous.
Hey!
The Lord our God is holy. The Lord our God is righteous.
Yes.
The Lord our God is holy. The Lord our God is righteous.
The awesome God.
He's an 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 awesome God.
Come on, clap your hands. Come on. He's a whole.
God is blessing her and sustaining her. We thank God that the Lord has left these senior soldiers still in our midst, and we praise God for them so very, very much. It's going to be the joy of our hearts tonight to hear the word of the Lord from the premier chief minister of the gospel in the Church of God in Christ worldwide. He has been a blessing to the people of the Lord. There's a peace about the Church of God in Christ, a unity, a harmony, a level of togetherness that I have never seen in the history of our church. While at the same time, lightning speed progress is being made. Our headquarters facility is being renewed. The property all the way to Crump has been purchased, blocks and blocks of property. And we have long wanted that property. And under the leadership of our presiding bishop, we now own all the way to Crump Boulevard. Those of you who know the city of Memphis, Tennessee. Such a tremendous blessing. Significant innovations have come to us under the leadership of this man of God. So he's known as the church leader. He's known as a builder. He's known as a leader. But most of all, G.E. Patterson is known as a gospel preacher. Amen. And we're going to hear the word of the Lord from our leader on today. The choir is going to come with a selection. Sister Judy McAllister, we praise God for you. Sister McAllister had spine surgery extensive and radical spinal surgery, so extensive that a rib was removed from her side and incorporated into her spine. And God has blessed her with such wonderful recovery. Did I say that right? All right. She's back. This is all since the month of March, and they're going to minister to us now. We love her and praise God for her. After the choir has given this sermonic selection, we're all going to stand, and thunderous applause will pour forth from us as our leader comes to share the word of the Lord.
Oh, Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God. Jehovah, we praise you. As I sat listening to this choir and that most anointed voice leading that song, hallelujah, my mind kind of drifted back to the fact that the name that we have as Jehovah in its original Hebrew is the word Yahweh, and the name that we have as Jesus is the name in Hebrew Yahshua. And so many names that God revealed himself in the Old Testament. He's Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who does provide. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace. And when you get through going down the entire list, God presented to us in the New Testament the embodiment of all that Jehovah is when he wrapped it up in his son Jesus. So, hallelujah. So when I am sick, I don't have to remember Jehovah Rapha, the Lord my physician. When I'm in need, I don't have to remember Jehovah Jireh, him who does provide. If I'm in battle, I don't have to remember Jehovah Nisi. But everything I need is wrapped up in the name of Jesus. Somebody ought to just lift up holy hands and give praise and glory to the magnificent name, the majestic name of Jesus. Hallelujah. My soul magnify you. Oh God, we just want to thank you for another opportunity to stand before your saints and to declare the unsearchable riches of Christ. Lord, we ask tonight that you would just let us be a channel through whom heaven's resources will flow through to your saints upon the earth. That you would hide us behind your glorious cross and cover us with your precious blood, allowing no flesh to glory in your sight. And whatever you do, Lord, we'll take no credit, but we give you all the praise, all the glory, and all of the honor through Jesus Christ our Lord. Come on and praise him one more time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Now before you sit down, just reach over and touch somebody and tell them Jesus is in the room. And I command you to be healed, be delivered, and be set free. Oh yeah. Hallelujah. Hey, my. Thank you, Lord. Well, take your seats. Let me back up and do this right. But I just feel an anointing in this place tonight. Woo! Glory. Anybody in here can... Do you feel what I feel? I know... I know that teaching today is of such that they tell you, you know, don't worry about feeling. And we don't walk by faith. We don't walk by feeling. We don't walk by sight. We do walk by faith. But I'm like the old folk that said I wouldn't have a religion that I couldn't feel. And every once in a while I want to feel him breathe on me. Hallelujah. Glory. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Let me back up and do this right. I certainly do give praise, glory, and honor to God, our Heavenly Father, and our blessed Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And special recognition and appreciation for the tremendous ministry gift that God has given to the Church of God in Christ and to the world in the personality of your jurisdictional prelate, my first assistant presiding bishop of the Church of God in Christ Incorporated worldwide, the inimitable Bishop Charles E. Blake. Yes, yes, praise God for him. Bishop Blake and I pledged to each other many years ago that we would never allow the politics of the church to break up our friendship nor interfere with our ability to appreciate the gift of God that was in the other person. And I say this with no hesitation and reservation, that I could not want a more capable and loyal person to serve in the office of First Assistant Presiding Bishop than Bishop Charles Blake. Amen. I'm also so appreciative, surprised, but yet appreciative for the fact that our fellow apostle and member of the general board, even in the midst of his trying time, Bishop George Dallas McKinney would come to be with us on tonight. So happy for him. And to our other bishops who are present on tonight, Bishop Goodman, Bishop Moore, Bishop Perry, and to our visiting bishop from the Church of God who I just met on this evening, we're so happy for each and every one of them. I had the blessed privilege, and let me also take this time to recognize all of these administrative assistants and superintendents, pastors, and to this great supervisor for the Department of Women, who not only leads the women's department in Southern California, number one, but is also one of the great personalities of our women's department worldwide. Yes. Supervisor Barbara McCoo Lewis. God bless her. And the First Lady, who I have known even longer than I've known the bishop. She and I kind of grew up together in the city of Detroit. And we're so happy for First Lady Mae Lawrence Blake. God bless her. As Bishop Blake already mentioned, I've had the privilege of being in the city after Bishop McKinney called and asked me if I would come to be with them on Monday, and was already scheduled to be here Friday. I said, there's no need in me flying home and spending Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday and coming back out here Friday. So I'll just take advantage of these days and do a little resting and in my favorite way. Now, I know that golfing is the thing nowadays. But I say if the weather is good enough to golf, why be out there chasing a ball when I can be on the lake? So, so Bishop Blake lined it up with his brother, Elder J.A. Blake, Jr., and he and Pastor Gerald Johnson, they were such cordial and congenial hosts for Tuesday, Wednesday, and then Thursday. They brought me into this area, and I got a chance to meet this great Pastor Clevester Williams. And he and Deacon Pullum, they were just so nice. And I hope I didn't overdo it. But after laboring and not all together like Peter and catching nothing, I did catch one. Pastor Williams in his motorhome, he had dinner on the stove. And we just had a great time on yesterday with him. Got a chance to meet his wife, even as I had a chance to go and look in on Mother Blake. And Mother Blake, when I was talking to us, I hadn't talked to her in years. I said, "Oh, you don't know who I am." She said, "Something about that voice." And after saying one or two little things, I said to her, "Well, this is Gilbert." And before I could finish saying Gilbert, she said, "Oh, Gilbert Patterson." And I said, her mind is so unusually sharp at this point in her life. And I can just concur with what Bishop Blake said about all of these great pioneers. I look down and see Mother Herndon. And I think about those days during the lifetime of Bishop L.C. Page when they were the team that led the evangelist department. And I was the youngest evangelist, and Bishop Page called me his son Timothy. And I have seen those days, and Bishop Blake and I were both just teenagers coming up, watching the old men. And now the clock kept ticking, and we are the old men. But thank God, because either you become the old man and the old woman, that I take the other alternative. I prefer to be the old man. Amen. Yeah. I debated what to speak on tonight, day before yesterday, while we were fishing, and the line that I was using, I didn't have my own rigging, and the line got so tangled up until I told Elder Blake, "I think the Lord must be telling me to preach on entangled." But when I found out tonight was ordination, I said, "No, that must not have been the Lord." So I want to share with you from the word of the Lord. And we will go to the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10. And we will look at verse 44. I have spoken from this subject about two or three times within the last 30 days or so. And I feel directed in that way on tonight. The Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, verse 44 through the end of the chapter, verse 48. It simply says, while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then prayed they him to tarry certain days. Verse 44 is where we will draw our subject. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word. I want to talk to you from this theme, the power of the word. The power of the word. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word. I would submit to you that you could receive the Holy Ghost, healing, deliverance from oppression, salvation for your family, and any other desired blessing if you would just hear the word. This particular subject came to my mind a few weeks ago because each year between Resurrection Sunday and for the interim of the successive 7 weeks leading up to Pentecost Sunday, we always celebrate the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, our Holy Spirit, upon the early believers in the upper room. For the last 2 or 3 years, I have been stirred as I have traveled this country in the office of presiding bishop to remind the saints of the Church of God in Christ that it is this one experience that brought this church into existence. Well, I know Bishop Mason initially organized his first church under the name Church of God in Christ in 1897. But at that time, it was not considered to be a Pentecostal church, but it was a holiness church. But when he heard about the great revival that was being held in this city on Azusa Street, that he traveled to Los Angeles, California, and in that great revival received the gift of the Holy Ghost with the signs of speaking with other tongues. And it was that experience that when he came back to Memphis and called for those within the organization who believed in the Pentecostal experience, as we choose to call it now, with receiving the Holy Ghost with the signs of speaking with other tongues, that caused he and C.P. Jones to separate. And because God had given Bishop Mason the name, C.P. Jones had to choose another name, and that church yet exists under the name Church of Christ Holiness. But the Church of God in Christ from that point, from 10 congregations, grew to be one of the most powerful spiritual entities in the world. And for 100 years, the church has continued to grow. But now I'm afraid that too many of us have forgotten what it is that makes us different. I even go to some places and find out that they don't even preach the Holy Ghost anymore. They don't even teach the Holy Ghost anymore. They just join the church, give the preacher their hand, give God their heart, and keep on doing what they've been doing. But I believe that if it was the power of the Holy Ghost that brought us from nowhere to prominence, that same power is what it's going to take. Because believe it or not, the challenges that lay before the church today are even greater than those of yesterday. I do not attempt to take anything away from our forefathers. They had to blaze the trail. You see those great freeways that go throughout this area of the country and jam packed with automobile traffic. But before the superhighways were built, somebody had to first of all cut down trees, travel a dusty road, later on the gravel, then the concrete, and then they came up with different versions of the blacktop, and eventually the narrow roads were widened. So God put it into our foreparents to blaze the trail. And in those days, I can even remember as a youngster growing up, when people looked upon us as a bunch of barbarians, more or less. Other churches had their full audience on Sunday morning. We didn't have many folks Sunday morning, but they came from far and near on Sunday night because they wanted to see us dance. They'd come in and sit in the back and watch the saints. And every once in a while, somebody would be, we said in those days, knocked out under the power of the Holy Ghost. Your modern language now is slain in the spirit. And if a sister was slain in the spirit, and she already had on long dress and cotton stockings, but if the Spirit of God was moving and that lady fell out and started rolling in the floor, one of the mothers would quickly run and grab something and throw it over her legs. And all they were doing was trying to keep the brothers in the spirit. But the critics went out and said they're holy rollers. They're down there rolling in sheets, and they said all kind of stuff. And now, the thing that I cannot understand is, if God was doing that in the Church of God in Christ when I was a youngster, and my next birthday I'll see the official senior citizen age of 65, and if we were back there into the Holy Ghost and gifts of the Spirit, when in the other churches, if somebody just raised their hand and said hallelujah, the usher was there to see them out the door. And now, within the last 30 years or so, let me say it this way. Those who have come into the knowledge at a later date, they do not use the word Pentecostal, but they use the word charismatic. And they have become our teachers. And we are leaving from the university of the Holy Ghost experience to go to the kindergarten. And we are thinking that we are not up to par because we are not like them. God first led us in. They ought to be trying to be like us. What is the difference? The difference is that we believed that sanctification, first of all, you're saved, you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, but then you sanctify yourself. And that sanctification and holiness was a part of receiving the Holy Ghost. But now what has happened is the old doctrine of once in Christ and never out, eternal security. And they're teaching you that you are, the believer is indwelled by the Holy Spirit the moment of your confession of faith in Christ. And that when you were born again, you got it all. And all you have to do is develop your prayer language. So they send you to the tongue room to teach you how to talk in tongues. But I'm glad I came along when we were speaking as the Spirit of God gave utterance. I'm glad that God did not give me a dumb Holy Ghost that somebody else had to teach how to talk. You see, Jesus said in John chapter 7, read it, verses 37, 38, 39, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, said, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. And he that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Then that next verse is parenthetical. But this spake he of the Spirit. In other words, when he said living water, he was not talking about formula H2O, but he was talking about living water as the Holy Ghost. This spake he of the Spirit, which they that believed on him would receive, because the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Now listen at the difference. Jesus said, believe on me as the scripture have said, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Now he's talking about the abundance of praise that will flow forth from deep down within you when you receive the Holy Ghost. Now, if you go into the tongue room, it comes out of their mouth, through your ear, and out of your mouth. But when it's the real Holy Ghost, it doesn't come through your ear and out of your mouth, but from way down on the inside. Rivers of living water. I'm sorry, I know I'm stepping on some of y'all's toes, but I just got to tell it like it is. The Holy Ghost is that power that the church must have. We can't do God's work without the power of the Holy Ghost. I mean, this is seen all the way through the Bible. I mean, in the very beginning, in the book of Genesis, God, when he first spoke everything into existence, and this brings in the power of the Word, because the power of the Word has always been there. I know that the scientists will tell you that theory is that the universe was brought into existence by the Big Bang. I'll agree with that. It was the Big Bang that brought this universe into existence. I can tell you what the Big Bang was. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was void and without form. Water was upon the face of the deep. And God spoke and said, let there be. That was the Big Bang. It was the voice of the Creator speaking out and rumbling over chaos and bringing order out of disorder. Hallelujah. So the Word was always there. The Word was there, and the Spirit was there from the very beginning. And when God begins to make man, after he speaks everything else into existence, he forms man from the dust of the ground. There he is standing there like a department store mannequin. Everything is in place. Hallelujah. The head is erect. The torso is there and all of the extremities. And there he stands. But he doesn't have any life until God breathes into him. Into his nostrils the breath of life. And it is that breath, the pneuma, the wind of God coming into him that causes him to have life. The same thing happens in the book of Ezekiel in chapter 37. Somebody said that there were two armies that had collided in battle. They retreated so quickly, something happened until they were not able to bury their dead. And here are the dead armies of bodies lying there. And the buzzards are coming down and the jackals are walking through. And after picking the flesh from the bones, and when the sun has bleached the bones and they have become dry, and here they are scattered, so scattered, and the foot of the jackals walking through, and the buzzards have caused the bones to become disarranged. And here you've got toe bones lying up somewhere by the skull. Oh my God. And that's the way it is in the church sometimes. Looks like everybody's trying to be the leader. Everybody want to be the head. Everything was just a conglomerated mess. And the Lord said to Ezekiel, "Son of man, can these bones live?" He said, "Lord, I don't know, but you know." And God's answer was, "Prophesy or preach to the bones." And you don't have to have but one sermon, and that's all ye dry bones. Hear the word of the Lord. And when they kept crying, "Old dry bones, hear the word," all of a sudden bones began to come together and they stand up in order, but they are still dry. After they are covered with skin, they are still dry. They are standing there. Every organ is in place, but there is no life until God says to him, "Now, preach to the wind." And he turned his back to the south and called for the north wind. Turned his back to the north and called for the south wind. Stood with his back to the east and called for the west wind. Then turned his back to the west and called for the east wind. And when the wind got through blowing, it was only when the wind, the breath of God, when it got through blowing, all of a sudden there was a shaking in the valley. Say what you want to. You can have the most beautifully robed choirs. Everybody, the preachers can have on their vestments. And we do it every Sunday in Memphis. Oh my God, we are arrayed. We put it together. Everything looks good. But I want you to know that dressed up doesn't bring the spirit. Organization does not bring the spirit. Hallelujah. And the church is just like a bunch of dry bones if you don't have the spirit. Oh, hallelujah. Say what you want to. When the spirit of God is at work within the church, everything that God wants to happen will happen. People will be saved. They'll be filled with the Holy Ghost. They'll be healed. They'll be delivered from habits. But it only happens when the Spirit of God is at work. Oh my God, I don't know why I opened this book of notes. I'm going all together a different way. But hopefully it'll bless somebody tonight. Now, the thing about the power of the word, as I said, was always evident. It was evident by God in creation. It was evident even when Moses led the children of Israel out of Egypt. They come down to the banks of the Red Sea, and we've always given the credit to Moses stretching out the rod. But I want you to know something that happened that maybe we did not pay any attention to. Go back and read in Exodus chapter 14, verses 15 and 16. And the Lord said unto Moses, evidently he prays a prayer that is not recorded. When the people began to complain, Moses evidently cried out to God. But God said, "Why are you crying out unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward." Then he goes on to say, "But lift up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry land through the midst of the sea." But before he stretched out the rod, the first thing the Lord said was, "Speak to the children and tell them to go forward." That's what really opened up the sea. Because now, if the wilderness is on one side, and the mountains are on the other, and Pharaoh's host is behind, and the Red Sea is in front. Where can you go? You can't go to the wilderness. You can't go to the mountain. You can't turn around and go back unless God tells you. If God says go to the right where the mountains are, that means he's going to move back the mountain. If God says go to the left where the wilderness is, somehow he's going to turn the wilderness into more organized type of a tapestry. If he tells you to turn around and go back against where your enemies are, that means he's going to cut down the enemy. But if he says go forward and there's nothing there but a sea, either he's going to build a bridge or there are going to be some ships, or he's going to do what he did. He opened up the sea and dried it out because his word was go forward. Oh, you got to understand that when God speaks, everything in creation has to line up with what God says. If God says you are blessed, can't nobody curse you. If God says go forward, it doesn't matter how many storms arise. The storms can't stop you. If God says move, you've got to do what he says. Why? Because the power is in his word. I'm gonna hurry up and end this. Peter got an opportunity to see how powerful God's word was. Now, he did not know at the time what we know in hindsight. When the Lord said to him, Peter, James, John, you fellas, you're the fishermen? Yes. Well, what have you got to show? Well, we've toiled all night and haven't got anything. And in fact, we were just washing our nets. Washing the net meant that they were giving it up. They were going to quit, at least for a season. But Jesus said, take those same nets, go back into the same water, and let down for a drought. But Lord, now we've already been there. Now, we've heard you talk. We know you're a great teacher, but we're fishermen by trade. And we know that it's no need in going out there. But nevertheless, at your word. And because they obeyed his word, waters that had been non-productive. I want to tell you, sometimes God sends you back into the same water that had been non-productive. But you can go back into the same church, back into the same neighborhood, back to the same auxiliary, back to whatever your field of labor may have been, and nothing was happening. But if God says go back and try it again, you're going to see things happen in the same location where nothing happened before. He said, nevertheless, at thy word. And because his word was go, they went out into the sea. And all of a sudden, non-productive waters began to yield a harvest of fish. Peter got to understand the power that there was in the word of the Lord. He was somewhere around when that Roman centurion said to Jesus. One gospel writer says that the men of Israel, the leaders, had intervened and said to the Lord Jesus, the man's servant, the centurion's servant is sick. And he is worthy for you to do something for him because he built us a synagogue. So Jesus decided, all right, I'll go and heal the man's servant. And the centurion said, wait a minute. I'm not worthy for you to come under my roof. But I have been observing you. And I want you to know that I can compare what you do in the realm of the spirit with what I do in the natural realm. I'm a centurion. That means the word centurion having to do with being in authority over 100 soldiers. Now, you know, 100 soldiers, it wouldn't take 100. 10 of them could commit mutiny. And that would be nothing that that centurion could do to defeat 10 men. So why would 100 men obey one? Not because that one was in authority, but because he was under authority. Now you got to get the difference, because we're living in a day when, religiously speaking, everybody who think they've got a call, they want to be in authority. I've never seen so many bedroom bishops. What do I mean, bedroom bishop? He don't have nobody but his wife, two kids, a dog and a cat, and he calls in somebody to consecrate him. I've never seen so many self-made apostles. People that want title but don't understand the office. The thing is, they don't want anybody over them. They want to be able to say, I'm in authority. Now, you got to understand, when you are in authority, the buck stops here. Everything that happened, you it. Every mistake, you are it. Everybody that need money, you are it. All of the laws to enforce them, you are it. But when you are under authority, this Roman centurion could control 100 soldiers, not that he was in authority, but he was under it. They understood that if 100 rose up against the one, that one, he had over him another one of Caesar's generals. And that general controlled legions. And then over him were those who were next to Caesar. And then that was Caesar himself that could bring the whole Roman Empire to bear against those 100. Oh my God, when you're under authority, it's good to know that there are some things that come from higher up. God so beautifully arranged the church of God in Christ that you've got members that are under their pastors that are under their superintendents, and pastors and superintendents under their bishop, and our bishops are under the general board, and the general board, we are under the general assembly. Everybody in God's church has to report to somebody. Everybody's got to be under authority. This man said, because I'm under authority, I can say to this one, go here, and he goes. Say to this one, do that, and he does it. He said, I've been watching you, and I know you are under authority. I know that sickness has to obey you. Demons have to obey you. Diseases have to obey you. Because when you speak with the authority of heaven. And when you tell a disease to go, it's got to go. Because the heavenly Father is over you. So since I know who you are, you don't have to come into my house. Just speak the word. If you speak the word, my servant will live. Somebody ought to say, Lord, speak the word. Peter saw the power of the word. So when Cornelius, a Roman centurion, sent for him and said, I need you to come, Peter didn't want to go. Peter was somewhat of a bigot. He didn't want to mix with Gentiles. God had to get him ready. You know how God prepared him. He was hungry, went up on the roof waiting for dinner, fell into a trance, and God, my daddy used to say, took him to what looked like a moving picture show. A sheet let down from heaven, knitted at four corners. He saw on it all manner of four-footed beasts, creeping things. And a voice said, arise, slay and eat. Peter looked and said, No. What I see up there, I can't eat that. It's not kosher. I see swine. I can't eat that. He evidently saw a big lobster and a shrimp coming across. And God had told them, you can read it, whatsoever is in the sea that has fins and scales. I don't care how you like it, lobster have a shell that don't have fins and scales. It doesn't matter how you like catfish. It's got fins, but it don't have no scale. So they couldn't eat any of that. But the Lord said, what I have cleansed, don't you call common. Three men are looking for you. I know under normal circumstances you wouldn't go, but go with them, doubting nothing. About that time, there was a knock on the door. They said, we've come from Cornelius. He wants you to come to Caesarea. Peter walked in, took a text, preaching kind of in a really nonchalant way. He said, well, the word I say, you know, I'm not telling you anything new about this man back there in Judea that God highly favored and anointed him, and he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And he talked about Jesus. And there's something about Jesus. It's not just the word. See, the word is not powerful because of what it is. The word is powerful because of who it is. You see, in the beginning was the word. And the word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. John 1:14 says, and the word was made flesh. So when you begin to talk about Jesus, that's the heights of preaching the word. And I want to say to you men that are being ordained tonight, you're going to have many temptations. They're going to want you to preach the latest that's going on in Hollywood. They're going to want you to preach the latest that's in the magazines. But if you keep one text, Jesus, he's the only one that can save you. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name under the heavens given among men whereby we must be saved, other than the name of Jesus. Muhammad can't do it. Laodice can't do it. Confucius can't do it. Sun Yat Moon can't do it. Hare Krishna can't do it. But at the name of Jesus, every knee must bow, every tongue confess. Preachers, preach Jesus. Healing is in him. Deliverance is in him. Power is in him. Deliverance is in him. Preach Jesus. Touch three people and say, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I'm going to have to close this. But the Bible said, why Peter spake these words, Holy Ghost, it didn't fall on one or two, but it fell on all them that heard the word. I want you to know that God wants everybody in the church to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You need him. You got to have him. Somebody say, preach, are you saying that I can't get to heaven without the Holy Ghost? No, that ain't what I'm saying. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. If you have Jesus, you won't perish. You don't need the Holy Ghost to get into heaven. You need him right down here. He's your comforter. He's your guide. He's your teacher. Woo! The Holy Ghost is the paraclete. He's the divine helper that will lead you through this maze of confusion. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, wait until he fill you. Wait until he baptize you. Wait until he sets your very soul on fire. Oh, you need the Holy Ghost. How many folk in here know you've got him? I'm not talking about I got it. The Holy Ghost is not an it. But he is the indwelling power of God. You can get him while you're praising God. You can get him when you're coming up out of the water from being baptized. You can get him from the laying on of hands. Yay! You can get him while the word is going forth. You got to do is reach out by faith and tell him, fill. Get on your feet and give him praise in the house. Glory. You won't leave it like you came. In Jesus' name, bound, oppressed, afflicted, sick or lame, for the power of the Lord is still the same. Glory. So just tell somebody, you won't leave here like you came in the Jesus name. Glory. Woo! As we stand in the presence of God tonight, I declare unto you that the power of the Holy Ghost has directed and is directing the Word of God into your situation. Hey. I don't know what it is that you need from God, But we have this directive from God's word, that if any two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything, you can ask what you will, and it shall be granted. We've taken that to mean touch and agree. And I want everybody in here to turn to one somebody, catch them by both of their hands. If there's a third party near you, you can include that third person in your circle. The person that you're holding by the hand, I want you to agree. I don't want you to go into any intricate details, but I want you to just confide. The Bible says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. If your problem is one of ill health, just tell that person, pray with me concerning my health. If it's a financial problem, you don't need to go into detail. Just tell them, agree with me concerning my finances. If it's a domestic problem, tell them, join me in prayer for my home. Preachers, if it's a church and look like it won't grow, tell them, agree with me that God will begin to enlarge my ministry. Whatever it is, just in a moment of agreement, and then I want you to begin to pray into the life of that person. Don't ask God for anything for yourself. They're praying for you, and you pray for them. Satan, I command you to take your hands off. These are God's children. This is God's property. These are the saints of the Most High, and His word have declared that they should have every righteous desire. From the crown of their heads to the sole of their feet. These who are seeking even the Holy Ghost, let the Spirit begin to pour forth from deep down in their belly. Yes, under the Lord. Hallelujah. Receive it. Receive His healing. Receive His strength. Receive His touch. Hallelujah. And when you get through praying, just start giving Him praise. Praise Him. The blessing is on the way. Give Him glory. Hey, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo. Now shout unto the Lord with a praise of victory. Minutes and make the devil real mad. You know, we always talking about putting him under your feet. And one day I was just thinking about it. You know, Lord, now I know the Old Testament, the psalmist talks about dancing. But where did I get justification in the New Testament for praising him in the dance. And he first showed me the prodigal son when he came home, and that was music and dancing. But the Lord said the other place is when you put the devil under your feet. Lord, what have that got to do with dancing? He said, when you dance, you're just putting them under your feet to rhythm. Oh, you don't hear what I'm saying. Make the devil real mad. And for about 2 minutes, just dance on his head. Oh, my shahay. Clap those hands and take your seat if you can. Hallelujah. See, that's the way God wants to bring it back, where he just lay out who he want to. Because, see, we've gotten into this thing now, if the Holy Ghost don't knock folk down, we have these assisted slayings in the spirit. But when the Holy Ghost is doing it, he don't need no help. Oh! Oh yeah, that's another one. See, this is the kind of Holy Ghost service I started contending for the Lord to give us at our church. And now, seldom have a prayer line. If somebody wants an experience of being slain in the spirit, all they got to do is just get up and tell the Lord, here I am. Lift up, oh, shot, top, top. and lift up those hands and just let him have his way. He don't need no help. He don't need no push. He'll just send his own wind. Hey! I know the Holy Ghost, there's only one baptism, but there are many refillings. I know we got something else to do, so I'm going to cut off. But are there about 50 people in here that you want God to do it again? Want him to fill you all over again? Just leap to your feet and throw up your hands and tell him, Lord, do it again. Jesus. Sit down. Woo. Oh, the glory of your presence. Thank you, Jesus. Saints, I'm getting ready to give up the microphone, but one thing I want you to do for me, and I want you to do this quickly. I want to appreciate Bishop Blake for the unselfish way in which he appealed to the Lord's people tonight on behalf of this your servant and our ministry. But one thing the Lord put in my spirit, that when I do go to the various jurisdictions, I do not want my visit to that jurisdiction to serve as an undue expense. See, I understand. I know that you all have a beautiful system in this jurisdiction, but I also know that you also heavily depend upon what comes out of the convocation to help meet your annual budget. And the Lord just dropped it in my spirit to ask tonight every person in this building that would be so kind as to respond to the voice of this your chief servant and worship the Lord with a special gift of $21. If just 21 people will give a gift of $100, and everybody else in the building who can and will would share a gift of $21. What did I say? 21 people who will share $100, but everybody else to share a gift of $21. If you do that, we would leave with this jurisdiction an appreciable amount. I'm going to pray, and following this prayer, I want every one of you that's responding in either one of those categories, I'm going to ask you to stand following my prayer. If you're one of those 21 that will give $100, if you will be one of the persons to give $21, I want you to stand up quickly as soon as I conclude this prayer. And now, gracious and loving Heavenly Father, I want to thank you. I want to thank you, Lord, for these days that you have given us to refresh our body, our mind, and spirit here in the beautiful country of Southern California. I want to thank you, Lord, for the hospitality that has been shown by your saints. I want to thank you, Lord, for how you have anointed your word tonight, and that your people might have something to take home and meditate over and be blessed for days to come. And now, Lord, I ask a special blessing upon those who would hear your servant's voice and would respond in a monetary way, in order that this ministry of Southern California First Jurisdiction might be blessed. Hallelujah. I know that your anointing is on this service, and everyone that will sow seeds into this anointing tonight, you're going to multiply. Higher. You're going to multiply. Every gift, 100-fold, and give back to the giver. In Jesus' name, I thank you for everyone who will stand at this time to sow into this anointing.
Place the candidates before the altar. Oh, here am I. Lord, send me. If you cannot pray like Peter, if you cannot preach like Paul, you can tell the love of Jesus, and you can say he died for all. Oh, here am I, Lord, send me. Oh, here am I, oh, Lord, send me. Here am I, Lord, send me. Here am I. And the word of the Lord says, I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. But you be watchful in all things. Endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. For Paul said, I'm ready to be offered up, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. Finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not to me only, but unto all who have loved his appearing. Like to hear from the chairman of the ordination committee. Who are these men?
Bishop Blake, there are 33 ministers that have gone through the intensive instructions and help from six outstanding pastors that make up the ordination board. The process, we feel, is a little unique. They have been in constant meetings monthly, at least one time for 9 months. And this message tonight of sanctification and holiness is certainly one thing that the six of us have tried to instill and help them to get it, and I tell you they have it. We thank you, Bishop, for the opportunity to serve and give some time to answer questions and to do the work of the ministry. I would like for them to see the six men, amen, that have made up this board. Elder Henry Knight, Doctor, and each one of them has a specialty that we deal with to be sure that they are getting a rounded understanding what the ministry is all about. Elder Knight deals with disapproved doctrines that we feel that men going out, they better know in what they believe. And our church disapproves some doctrines. Dr. James Stovall gives great instruction in outlines and sermon preparation. And we try to get them not to say amen before they have said something. Many other things. Superintendent Trimble deals with the articles of religion and also dealing with other things. And he is the one that we give them tests because we don't want to spend that much time and they leave and didn't get nothing. So the tests are given and they have passed that test. Superintendent McNair is our secretary, deals with the ordinances of the church and other areas, and acquainted them with many, many words and expressions that they need to be familiar with as they read the Bible and as they go forth. Dr. Rogers deals with the history of the Church of God in Christ. My job has been to open up on each meeting, and we want every minister that comes through the process to know truly what an ordained elder should be like. They absolutely have to read 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus, and dealing with other parts of the scriptures. We feel that for the 21st century, we need sound men, sound in the gospel, sound in the faith. And we take time to answer their questions and things of that sort, where their questions of confusion and things of that sort, and I think that we are prepared to do that. God bless you, Bishop, and thank you for the process. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Let's give this ordination committee a rousing applause. Holy brethren and saints of God, we bring before you and God these following ministers to be ordained to the Christian ministry. After due examination and recommendations from the proper authorities, we present these persons before you and before God. But if there be any of you who know any valid reason for which any of these men ought not be received into this holy ministry, come forth in the name of God and disclose to me the impediment. Let us pray. Dear God, we ask your wisdom and your blessing upon us. This act that we perform this night cannot really add to these men of God anything that you, through the power of your Holy Spirit, do not confer directly upon them. We ask for us, dear Lord, your guidance and your blessing and your wisdom. We ask for them, your power, that you will so work in their lives that they will be committed to thy glory, committed to thy work. And let the earth, dear Lord, be impacted by the ministry that you will give to these men. For we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Dearly beloved brethren, we've come to this most serious and important act to ordain you as ministers of the Lord Jesus Christ. We've come to present you to God as watchmen and stewards of the Lord. You are to teach, preach, admonish, feed the flock, lead them to spiritual pastures, full and green. I charge you before God and before these witnesses that you preach the word of God, that you commit yourself to this charge, and that you commit yourself to Jesus Christ, who is the door of the sheepfold and the eternal church. We do hope and pray that you, as ministers of Jesus Christ, will keep as a trust this ministry which has been delivered to you by Jesus Christ himself, showing yourself an example in every good work before all the people. To be ordained to the Christian ministry gives you the right, the privilege to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, to visit and pray for the sick, to care for the widows and fatherless, to bury the dead, to bless homes and sacred buildings, to marry those who are eligible, and lead and live a godly life as a minister of Jesus Christ. Do you believe in your heart that you are truly called of God to preach the gospel? You will answer, I do believe. Do you believe the Holy Bible to be the inspired word of God to lead all to eternal life by salvation and the only rule for our faith and practice? If so, you will say, I do believe it is. Are you willing to preach the word of God, to uphold the doctrine of Christ and the doctrine of the church of God in Christ, and to perform the ordinances of the church? You will answer, by the help of God, I will. Will you be diligent in prayer and fasting and in reading of the word of God and doing what is contained in the Holy Scriptures? And will you study to show yourself a workman that needeth not to be ashamed? You will answer, I will, the Lord being my helper. Will you be obedient to those who have the rule over you? Will you obey the Church of God in Christ's constitution, administration, and judicial governing laws as a minister of the Church of God in Christ? That means you have to obey your bishop. And you will answer, I will. So help me God. I would like for you all to kneel. I would like for Bishop Timothy Clark to come. He's going to lead us in a season of prayer. The presiding bishop. Didn't our presiding bishop preach tonight? Oh, what a blessed word. The presiding bishop is going to come. I would like to invite the other bishops here present also to join with us. And as Bishop Timothy Clark leads us in prayer, we will go and lay hands, the bishops, followed by this ordination committee, will lay hands on these men and consecrate them as ordained elders of the Church of God in Christ. Come, Bishop Clark.
The congregation, rise, please. And would you join your hearts in prayer with us as our bishop has led us now in this formal service of ordination? You become now participants with us as we sanction that which the ordination council the bishop and others have now given credence to. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, Thou who art from everlasting to everlasting, Thou who art our Creator, our Sustainer, our Savior, and our Lord, it is to Thee that we come tonight with thankful and grateful hearts that You have, through Your own Son Jesus, established the glorious Church of God in Christ. We thank You that on the coast of Caesarea Philippi, Jesus Himself said, "Upon this rock I will build My church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." We thank You that Paul tells us in the book of Ephesians that when Christ rose from the dead and ascended, that He had ascension gifts that He gave not only to men, but that He gave to the church as well. That among them were that of the prophet, the apostle, the evangelist, the pastor, and the teacher. And that Paul, in writing to Timothy and Titus, said to them that they were to ordain elders in every city. And so we thank You that Southern California jurisdiction number one comes tonight to fulfill the biblical mandate of ordaining elders in this jurisdiction. We thank You, first of all, for the prince and the prelate of this jurisdiction. We lift before You Bishop Charles Edward Blake, and we pray that the anointing of the Lord will continue to rest on him. We thank You for this ordination council, these six men who have given 8 months of their lives to the training and equipping of these 33 preachers who now become ordained elders. And so all of us as a worshiping people pray tonight that the anointing of God will fall and flow and freely move in this place, even as the hand of the presiding bishop is laid on them, even as the hand of their jurisdictional prelate is laid on them, even as the hand of the ordination council is laid on them. We would ask You tonight, sovereign God, that on top of the hands of these men of God, that they will feel the impression of another hand. Let them feel Your hand upon them tonight. We pray, God, in this 21st century, that a special anointing, a special endowment will fall on them and flow through them. We pray tonight that they will never stand on their own. They will never stand in isolation, but they will stand recognizing, realizing that they stand on the shoulders of men and women who have laid the foundation and already gone before. We pray tonight, God, for these 33 men, each of them representing a year in the earthly life of our ministry, of our Lord. 33 years You ministered on this earth. 33 preachers stand here tonight, one for every year of the life of our Lord. And so we pray tonight, blessed God, in the name of Jesus, that You will do something in them the likes of which You've never done before. We pray, God, that the praying spirit of Bishop Charles Harrison Mason will fall on them, that like Father Mason prayed, You teach them how to pray. We pray tonight that the preaching spirit of Bishop F.D. Washington will fall on them tonight, so that every time they open their mouth, they will thunder the gospel. Let the preaching spirit of Bishop J.A. Blake, let the preaching spirit of Bishop L.H. Ford, let the preaching spirit of Bishop Dale Husband fall on them tonight. Let the pioneering spirit of Bishop John Seth Bailey fall on them tonight. Let the anointing of God fall. Let the ecumenical spirit of Bishop James Oglethorpe Patterson fall on them tonight. God, let the preaching power of Bishop Bishop Gilbert Earl Patterson and Bishop Charles Edward Blake fall on them tonight. Let the spirit of Bishop O.T. Jones fall on them tonight. And after you've done that, would you let your spirit fall on them tonight? Fill them, anoint them, use them, baptize them in the name of Jesus. And we say thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on in here and let's rejoice in the power of God. Come on in, praise God. Glorify the Lord. Bless the name of God. The entire congregation, clap your hands and give praise to the Lord. You may stand up, my brethren. Come on and praise Him. Hallelujah. 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 This night is so memorable. Thousands of elders ordained would wish to have the distinction that you've had on this night, that the hands of the presiding bishop of the Church of God in Christ were laid upon you, consecrating you to this gospel ministry. At this time, Executive Secretary of the Jurisdiction, Elder Robert Cole.
Bishop Blake, the ordination class of 2004, I present the certificate for Elder Jimmy Lee Bowen. I will read the certificate. Church of God in Christ Incorporated, World Headquarters, Memphis, Tennessee. Bishop C.H. Mason, founder. Certificate of ordination. Know all men by these presents that Minister Jimmy Lee Bowen has been ordained a cleric in the Church of God in Christ and is now granted the title of elder as prelate of the First Jurisdiction of Southern California, jurisdiction in the state of California. I, Bishop Blake, attest that he has satisfied all requirements for ordination as prescribed by the Holy Scriptures and as contained in the Constitution of our beloved Church. He has also satisfactorily demonstrated his Christian experience. We therefore recommend him to be received of Christians everywhere as long as the present unity of the Spirit exists and while he maintains a godly life and a spiritual standard in teaching. Done this 11th day of June, 2004, Bishop G.E. Patterson, presiding bishop, Bishop Charles E. Blake, Sr., first assistant presiding bishop, Bishop J. Newell Haynes, second assistant presiding bishop, Elder A.Z. Hall, Jr., general secretary, Elder Jimmy Lee Bowen. Elder Jeffrey Brown. Elder Joe Busby. Elder Grant Angus Campbell. Elder Valerie Pierre Codio. Elder Bernard Curtis Davis. Elder Anthony Doris. Elder Alvin Terrence Dupree Jr. Elder Donnell Ford. Elder Autry Lee Fowler. Elder Howard Randolph Gaines. Elder John Gins. Elder Robert Lewis Harden. Elder Darrell Cortez Hartley. Elder Vernon Jones. Elder Terry Van Lee. Elder Mark Eliezer Leonard. Elder Lloyd Mark Lindsay. Elder Courtney Lewis Lynch. Elder Lindsay McDonald. Elder Kenneth Otis Mobley. Elder Roger Montgomery Jr. Elder Quentin Dwayne Moore. Elder Jermaine Nelson. Elder Peter Joseph Reed Sr. The Charles Lindbergh Smith Sr. Elder Sean Price Smith. Elder Raheem Jamal Mel Swan. Elder Manuel Lowe Thomas. Elder Lee Elroy Turner. Elder Clifton M. Wells. Elder Michael Patrick Williams. Elder Willard Earl Williams, Jr. Bishop, you have 4 appointments. These are appointments to their certificates for them.
I thought this was a whole additional line that we had missed. I was getting kind of worried about you all. All right, God bless you. Let's clap our hands for this class of elders. Let's praise God for each and every one of them. You may take your seats, my dear brothers. Come on, give them an applause as they go to their seats.